Okay, Jai Jinendra, everybody. My name is Captain Varia. I'm an adult teacher at Chandna Vidyapit School. And as most of you will know, this is we have gone online and virtual in terms of our adult classes. And today is our second session. Some video etiquette before we begin. Please keep your sound on silence during the talk. Questions will be taken at the end. However, if there's something you need clarification on during the talk, please do use the chat facility. Vinodbhai is quite happy to pause during the chat facility, during his talk, if there is something that needs clarification. This talk is recorded and the presentation will also be sent out afterwards. First, I'd like to invite Hina Benbora, one of our SCVP teachers, to start us off with prayers. Over to you, Hina Ben.
Jai Jinendra. Namo Arhantanam, Namo Namo. Namo Sitanam, Namo Namo. Namo Ariyanam, Namo Namo. Namo Vachayanam, Namo Namo. Namo Lui Savasavuram. Namo Lui Savasavuram. Eso Panche Namo Karo Sav Pav Panasano Mangalananche Savesim Adhamam Havai Mangalam. Adhamam Havai Mangalam.
Thank you very much, Hina Ben. I'd like now to invite Nileshbhai Kothari, who heads up Chandya Vidyapit School. Nileshbhai, over to you.
Jai Jinendra, everyone, and welcome to our second virtual class. As Ketan has said, Ketan Bhai is one of the teachers along with Vinodbhai and Hina Ben, and this is a great initiative to connect people from all over, not just London, but international, as Ketan Bhai has said. So welcome, everyone, and it's going to be another wonderful, engaging session. We will continue with these sessions on every Friday. So look forward to connecting with everyone on a virtual basis as we go through these sessions. I'll now hand back to Ketan Bhai.
Thank you so much, Nileshbhai. So before we have Dr. Vinodbhai start his talk, let me introduce Dr. Vinodbhai Kapashi. He is a civil engineer by profession and came to the UK in 1968. For decades, he has spent time promoting Jainism and written many books and articles on Jain subjects. His mammoth work, Navashmarna, Nine Sacred Recitations of Jainism, was his PhD thesis, and this book is widely referred by people all around the world. Dr. Kapashi received his OBE in 2019. Vinodbhai has been teaching at Chandya Vidyapit School for over 20 years, and every talk of his has been insightful and relevant. Today is part two of Vinodbhai's talk on Ahimsa Darshan. Before Vinodbhai starts, please make yourself, make sure you're on mute. And if you have any questions, please wait till the end, unless you need something that needs clarification. Over to you, Vinodbhai.
Thank you, Ketan Bhai. Can everyone hear me?
Yes, we can, Vinodbhai. Carry on.
Yeah, that's okay. Thank you, Jai Jinendra, and good evening. Right, our topic, as you all know, is Ahimsa, non-violence. And today is the second lecture of our topic, non-violence. I'm going to show you some slides. So let's begin. Can you all see these?
Yeah,
we can see fine.
You can see fine. Yeah. Okay, so as I said, it's all about ahimsa, non-violence, and I'm thankful to Sri Chanda Vidyapeeth, Ketan Bhai, Nilesh Bhai, and everyone for organizing this thing. And I hope more and more people will take part. I'm going to begin with a very, very nice quotation. This is from my favorite book, Les Miserables. It's been written by Victor Hugo, French novelist and a poet. It's a very famous book, and you might have read this book or seen film or a play in the West End. Victor Hugo has also written another book, you probably know about it, Hunchback of Notre Dame. That's also a very good book. And he was also a great philosopher and poet. In one of the books, he has said, "No army can stop an idea whose time has come." Now, are we talking about an idea? Yes, we are. But ahimsa is not just an idea. Ahimsa is much more than that. We can talk about vegetarianism, the ideal of vegan lifestyle, and how it has influenced this modern world. So everything starts from an idea. Then it develops and it develops more and it becomes a great movement. So we hope that the ideal of ahimsa will become a great movement and people will realize how important this ideal is. The idea of ahimsa, non-violence, is just an idea. No, it's a principle, philosophy, way of life, ideology for our survival. It's not just non-killing, it's more than that. Now, generally other religions, when they talk about ahimsa, non-violence, they said it's just non-killing. But for us Jains, it's not just non-killing, it's much more than that. And we'll see again what it means. Right, if you go through our scriptures, our holy books, you will read about ahimsa. And within the chapters of ahimsa and non-violence, you will read a lot of things. You should not do this, you should not do that. Sometimes people think, is it just a denial? Is it our scriptures, our gurus, they said that don't do this, don't do that. Is it just ahimsa? So is it something which is always in denial mode? Is it always something which is negative? Jains have given the fullest expression to the meaning of non-violence and included not only the visible, gross, and moving living beings. But also the immovable, static living beings, of the vegetable and other origins, such as earth, water, air, and fire-bodied living beings. It did not stop it saying that non-violence was not confined only to not killing any creature, but also to not hurting or compromising any of its 10 kinds of vitalities. Here, I'm going to introduce this new word vitalities. So Jain says that you should not hurt any vitalities. And here it says 10 kinds of vitalities. In the original language, it's called prana. Certain energy, certain functions, these are vitalities. And there are 10 vitalities. Which are they? These vitalities, as you can see here, 10 types of prana. Now the concept of violence is so firmly associated with the vitalities of the living beings that in the Jain tradition, violence is known as pranatipata. Any of the 10 pranas or 10 vitalities, if you damage it, if you take it away, that is called hinsa, violence. So which are these 10 prana or 10 vitalities? These are listed here. Sense of touch, sense of taste, sense of smell, sense of sight, and sense of hearing. What we call panch indriya, 5 senses. We human beings have 5 senses, and we can read the evolution of all types of human beings. Some have just one sense, that sense of touch. Some have got 2 senses, sense of touch, sense of taste. Then 3 senses, number 1, 2, and 3. 4 senses have got number 1, 2, 3, and 4. And the 5th is sense of hearing. If you want to hear, remember all these things, there is very easy way. Say if you have one sense only, so one sense beings have got just one sense of touch. And those who have got 2 senses, they have got touch and taste. So what you have to do is you make a line from there to there and go from there to there. It's like an inverted L. Easy to remember, isn't it? Now, out of these 10 types of prana, these 5 are senses. The 6th prana is a swas, swachoswas, respiration, or breathing. 7th prana is ayu, our longevity. And 8th is a physical energy, whatever, shakti, power. 9th is vachan or verbal vitality. And 10th is a man, mind. So these are 10 prana, 10 vitalities. And if you damage or if you kill or if you take away any of these vitalities, you have committed violence. Now let us see how many vitalities a living being has. The one-sensed living being has got vitality number 1, 6, 7, and 8. You can read that, these things at the bottom. These are the one-sensed living beings having vitality number 1, number 6, number 7, number 8. So that means you can see this in red. These are one-sensed living beings. They have got no vachan. They have got no mind. They cannot smell, they cannot see, they cannot hear, they cannot taste. These are the one sense living beings as per our Jain tradition. And those who have 2 sense, they have got vitality number 1, number 2, 6, 7, 8, and 9. And those got three senses. They got number 1, 2, 3, 6, 7, 8, 9. And four sensed beings have got 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9. And five sensed beings have got all 10 prans or 10 vitalities. So you can see the difference. And the degree of violence one can commit or one commits. So if you kill one sense being, you are taking away vitality number 1, 6, 7, and 8. And similarly, say if you kill four sense beings, you'll take away 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9. So there is a degree of violence involved in all these things. I think it is clear enough, and I'll move it to the next one. Now, hurting, injuring, or impairing any vitality of any being is, therefore, it's called violence. So the definition of violence is much more complex or very logical, and is very much in detail. In practice, now, we're talking about practicality now. It's not absolutely possible not to commit any violence. So we have to draw a distinction between absolute violence, non-violence, and practical non-violence. What is absolutely necessary and what we can do in practice. So what we do? Before I say that, we have got a very good saying in our scripture. Gautam Swami once asked Lord Mahavir, how can we sit? How can we stand? How can we lie down? How can we eat? What's the proper way? How can we speak? What's the proper way of doing all these things? And Mahavir Swami gave very good answer. Jayam chare, jayam chitthe, jayam ase, jayam soye, jayam bhunjatto, bhasanto, pavakammam na bandhai. It's worth remembering at every step in our life. Jayam chare. Whatever you do, do it with utmost care. Be vigilant. Jayam chitthe. How you stand with utmost care. Jayam ase. Kevi rite besvu. How would you sit? Again, jayam. With utmost care. Jayam soye, how you would sleep, how you lie down. Jayam bunjato, how would you eat? Pasanto, how would you speak? The answer is in just one word. And we know this word, jaina. I'm sure you all have heard this word, jaina. Jaina is care. Vigilance and looking for everything around you that am I doing this right? Am I not coming and doing any, committing any violence? That is jaina. You can see this word at the bottom. Our elders who do a lot of upvas, ekashna, ambil, everything, they generally use this word. We are doing this with jaina. So the root of this word is in our scripture, Acharanga Sutra.
Vinodbhai, Jayajinendra. Just yes. Before we move on, there are some clarification questions with the 10 pranas. Can you go back to the slide with the 10 pranas?
Yeah, sure. 10 prana, yeah.
Yeah, so The first one is Can we have example of a four-sensed being?
Four-sensed being, of course, is a simple thing. Human beings and most of the animals are five-sensed beings. There are certain creatures like snakes and other things, and I'm talking about not by the modern science. What Jainism says, they are four-sensed beings. And then there are three lesser beings, the lesser beings, and sense of touch are just very minute organism. Sometimes we even can't see them. There's a one sense. So then birds and other things, other creatures, frogs. So senses increases. And that's how you do. We are on top of the ladder. Five sense beings.
Thank you, Vinodbhai. Next question, just two more clarification questions. Why does the one sense being not have vitality nine?
Why is a very good question. But I am going by what our scriptures and what our holy book says. So it's very difficult to say that why they haven't got number nine ability to speak or ability to make noise. But that's the way. See, it's also like vegetable kingdom, plants and trees and other things. So they cannot speak. They cannot make noise on its own. So that's what our scripture says here.
Thank you, Vinodbhai. Please carry on.
Yeah. Right. There is another thing. We do a lot of things. Sometimes we do intentionally. Sometimes we do unintentionally. We don't mean to do those things. Sometimes it's sheer negligence. So the degree of violence has been described on the basis of negligence. Here, there are four types. Absence of A, that is negligence. If you have no negligence, if you are careful, and if nothing happens to anyone, this is the best type of ahimsa. Now, if you do not have any negligence, but some injury, something happens to some living beings, it's a middle category. Then presence of A. If you have negligence, but if you do not injure any living beings, that's again slightly lower middle category. That means you are not negligent. You are negligent, but nothing happens. The negligence, that means there is something in your mind, you do not care. You have no jhana. And without jhana, the life is not full of this ideal of ahimsa. You are likely to commit ahimsa. And here it says, presence of A and B both. That means you neglect everything and then you end up hurting creatures. This is the worst kind of things one can do. So the message here is the jhana again. Be vigilant, take care, don't act with negligence. Now we'll talk about positive side of ahimsa. So far we said that killing, hurting, other things. But I want to talk about positive side. And it's our duty to act this way. And the positive side of ahimsa, many a times it's called compassion. In Gujarati and Hindi we call karuna. There is a very good story, a little incident-like thing in the Hindu scriptures, in Upanishads. One sort of semi-gods, they went to Brahma, the creator god, and asked him, what is the essence of all religions? How we should live our lives? Oh Lord, could you describe in a very simple terms? Lord Brahma said, he said like a roaring cloud. He uttered only one word, one letter really. He said, the. I written the in Gujarati and then D in English. The Brahma said, the. Then second time, all these gods asked, Lord, please explain again how we should live our life. And the Brahma said, same thing again, the. The third time, these gods asked, Lord, how we should live our life. And the third time also, Brahma said, the. So what is this meaning of the? And how he could explain everything in just one little letter, a little word, right? Now the Supreme God, Brahma, explained. The first D, that is the, is for Daman. What is Daman? Daman is restraint, controlling your senses. That means no greed, no exploitation, no excesses, no violence. And you have to control your senses and you suppress your bad feelings. This is called Daman. This is the essence of religion. So starts with the Daman. The second the is Daya. Compassion. It's not just showing mercy, but Daya is the positive side, helping someone. Many a times we said that Jain logo is live and let live. I would say it's not just live and let live. Live and help others to live. This is Jainism. So Daya, compassion, helping others is the second part of religion. And the third, the, is charity, dana. So the essence of religion is very beautifully explained here in Hindu scripture Upanishad. The, and the. Daman, restrain. Jaina, the second the is Daya. And the third the is Dan, charitable activities, giving donation. The above three D's explain the concept of Ahimsa very beautifully. So if you know and if you practice all three D's, you will be practicing Ahimsa because you will have Daman, Jaina, then you will show mercy or you will practice compassion. And the third is you will be giving lots of things in charity. So let us see more Ahimsa in practice or compassion in action. Do Jains believe in compassion in action? This is a deep-rooted question in a lot of people's mind. Once a person asked me, whoever is suffering, whoever is in a bad state, is because of his bad karma. Is it our duty to help him? Now, I would say, what a misguided idea. You haven't really understood Jainism. Never mind the philosophy of karma. Even the philosophy of karma teaches us to show mercy and do meritorious deeds, punya karma. It may be karma, but punya karma is very much necessary. And that is what the compassion is all about. By and large, this idea is increasing now. I'm happy to say the ideal of seva, sadhana, and siksha, these three S's, are interwoven in Virayatan's work. If you go to India and see what Virayatan is doing, the Sadhiji is doing, Acharya Chandraji is doing, Silapiji is doing, this is seva. Service, helping mankind. When there was an earthquake in Gujarat in 2001, Acharya Channaji was one of the great leaders who went there first and took a vow that she is going to help these people. And now we can see in Kutch, schools, colleges, and they are helping poor as well. And the same thing in Virayatan Bihar, Virayatan Nepal, and Virayatan at other places. They have really lived the idea of seva, sadhana. Sadhana means worship or meditation, and siksha. Sikshan is education. Similarly, the other organizations, I must quickly mention, Srimad Rajchandra Mission Dharampur, under the guidance and blessings of Gurudev Rakesh Bhai, they are doing many humanitarian work, and they have established places like hospitals, schools, libraries. Saila group of Srimad Rajchandraji, similar work in Saila and all over the district of Surendranagar district in Gujarat. There are many other organizations. One of the notable organizations is Navkar Sarvar Kendra, always helping and treating injured animals. Wherever there is an accident, something happens to animals, they are the first ones to go, operate upon them, treat them. And they also do one more thing. They do Sarvar of sadhus and sadhvis too. So this idea of compassion in action is increasing. More and more Jain organizations are working towards it. And something more about this other thing, Panjrapur. Jains are very famous. Animal sanctuaries, animal shelters. Hundreds and hundreds of Panjrapols are there in India, where they look after the sick and crippled animals. And these animals are being looked after until their natural death. I'm sure you might have seen one or two Panjrapols while visiting India. If you haven't, when you go to India, go and visit Panjrapol and see how they are doing and how they are looking after the animals. The Dan. The third the Brahma, Lord Brahma said, the Dan, charitable activities, donations. How many types of Dan are there? The first is Annadan, providing food, feeding hungry people. Second dan is vastradan, donating your clothes. The third is asraydan, providing shelter. And the fourth is abhaydan, life-saving acts. These are all important. Annadan, Vastradan, Asraydan, and Abhaydan. We'll discuss a little bit more about that. But first, Abhaydan. Abhaya means what? Bhaya means fear. And Abhay means fearlessness. So Abhaydan is perhaps the greatest dan, because you are removing all fear from a person's life. There are all types of fears. Fear of disease, fear of death, fear of lots of other things, fear the thinking that something might happen to them, the calamities will come, all these. So Abhaydan is freeing them from those fears. And one aspect of Abhaydan, nowadays people are discussing more and more, is the donation of organs. Because that is again, donation of organ prolongs someone's life. The person becomes happy. He more or less lives healthier life and it removes all the fear from his heart. So that is Abhaydan. And you know, this movement is getting momentum. About the organ donation, a new law is also coming. And unless you opt out, your organs will be automatically donated. I'm not sure whether someone is here in today's group who has donated her or his organ. Last week, I know there was a lady who has given her kidney to her husband. Now, there are lots of examples in Jain history about Anukampa. Again, compassions. I'll give you just two examples, but I think let me go back one or two slides and talk about this Annadan and Vastradan. I'm sure you must have visited Gurudwaras operated by Sikh religion. They run langars. Langar is a place or an idea of providing free food to all visitors. Now, what they do is something worth saying, marvelous. And I can say with some confidence that no other religion does what Sikh people or Sikh religion does as far as Annadan is concerned. If you happen to go to India and go to Amritsar, one of the most beautiful place to visit for the Sikh religion, and see Golden Temple there, you will see that more than 5,000 people are being fed there every day. No questions asked that you are coming from which religion, from which place, are you rich or poor or hungry or not. Everyone is given free food. This 5,000 is the lowest figure I've said. It goes up to 50,000 people on days of celebrations and festivities. I've seen it myself and I've seen how they are operating. It's one of the marvelous things they do it. I remember one thing Kabir has said. Hindu poet is very famous. He said, Kabirai sansar me do bata sikhale, kar sahib ki bandagi aur bhukhe ko kuch de. Kabir says that please learn these two things in your life. Kar Sahib ki bandagi, worship your Lord, aur bhukhe ko kuch de, and just feed a hungry person. There was two things you'll have to learn in your life. And now we also know Vastradan and Asraydan and other things. There are a lot of English charities as well in this country doing marvelous job. Lots of Indian charities doing marvelous job. So these are the four types of Dan. Jainism also says one more thing. You have to do Supatradan. Supatradan means you have to see who is worthy, who is an appropriate person, and who deserves this thing. So that's called Supatradan. Sometimes our money is being wasted. So it's always better to look for where you are donating your money. In Jain history, there are lots and lots of examples. We have done charitable activities. Jagdusa, a merchant in the state of Gujarat, in Kutch, he had donated millions of rupees worth of grains. He was the biggest merchant in Gujarat at that time. And he gave everything during the time of famine when he came to know that people are dying of hunger and they've got nothing to eat. And he opened his cellars, his treasures, and donated everything what he had. Bhamasha, another donor. But how he gave money is also worth interesting. Mughal Emperor Akbar's army was capturing town after town, district after district in the state of Rajasthan. At that time, it was necessary to stop the destruction. And a brave man called Rana Pratap, he was fighting battles. He was fighting to get rid of these oppressors. And he was in dire need of money, funds. At that time, a Jain merchant, a rich person called Bhamasha, gave all his wealth to Rana Pratap to fight the Mughal army. So this was another type of donation. But here you might ask, why to fight? Was it necessary to fight? Of course it was necessary. And this is another point of another side of the ideal of nonviolence. Sometimes you have to fight for the greater good of mankind, to save your religion, to save your community, to save your country, to defend everything. So this lesser degree of violence is acceptable for greater good. And that is why I have mentioned the name of Bhamasha, because all he was trying to do is save his religion, save his country, save his area, save his people. And that is what he did. I'm not sure, Ketan Bhai, how we are going the time-wise.
Vinodbhai, we're doing fine. We're doing fine. We have quite a few questions, Vinodbhai.
So yeah, sure. We'll start answering then. I hope I'll be able to answer all. Yeah.
I'm sure you will. We have quite a few questions. So just before we start, could you just come off the screen share, Vinodbhai?
Stop share, yeah, okay.
Yeah, you might have to go back if someone wants to ask a direct question.
All right, yeah.
So just before we start, if anyone's got a question, please put it on the chat. on the chat right now, I put a running order of questions. When I do ask you to come on, please unmute yourself only then. And then please mute yourself after you've asked your question. Thank you. The first question is from Parul Ben. Parul Ben has asked me to ask this question from via chat. Her question, Vinodbhai, is how much charity work should I do? I think this is quite a deep question. How much charity work should I do?
Well, it depends from person to person. You have got certain responsibilities, I'm sure, towards your family, towards brothers, sisters, I don't know. I mean, I'm just saying generally, husband, children, parents, and you will need some money. So if you think that you can donate whatever you can after saving some, after keeping something, after looking after your immediate family members, then you should do that. And if you can donate some money by sacrificing your luxury, then please do that. Because we must always remember that there are people who are less fortunate than us. And this is very important. So, Parul Ben, it's great you are asking. Please try and donate whatever you can. And always think in your mind or make a resolution that, okay, today I'm able to give only this much, but I hope I'll be able to give more tomorrow and much more day after. Is it okay?
Thank you, Vinodbhai. Next is Bindi Ben. Bindi Ben, please ask your question.
Jai Chinendra, my question is on yeast. You know, Vinodbhai, you had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 sensed beings. Mm. So I was wondering, where would you place yeast? Because I believe yeast respires. So the respiration was number 6. Unless it causes a reaction and for something else to respire, I'm not really sure whether it is a living being or not.
No, respiration is always there in one sense, being two sense or whatever. Yeah, swachoswas is always there. So it is, that comes number 6. The other 7, 8, 9. Only the 9th man, the human beings have got that mind. Or the 5 sense being have got this here. So that's how Jainism has arranged all 10 vitalities, 10 prans. Go on, what is it, something you want to say in that?
Thank you. Well, I was just wondering where yeast would come in, but
what one?
You know, yeast?
Yeast.
Uh-huh. What do you think of that?
Perhaps one sense being, I'm not quite sure about the yeast, how it will come, you know. It's interesting because, you know, nowadays people talk about coronavirus.
And, yes, exactly.
I was trying to read a lot of things and searching Google and all these things. And my own question was, is this virus a living thing or what? And of course, the answer I found in Google that no, it's not a living thing. Although it has got certain proteins, it has got certain acids and certain strands, few strands of DNA, but it's not a living thing. It only grows or multiplies when it comes in contact of living cell. So virus is not a living thing, but bacteria are living things. And that is why bacteria can be killed by antibiotics, whereas virus cannot be killed by antibiotics. So yeast, again, I wouldn't know really for sure. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. That helps, yeah.
Thank you.
And in fact, we have been having discussions in the family about this, the coronavirus, yeah, whether it's a living thing or not, but I think you've answered the question now.
Yeah, well, as per this, my search, this virus is not a living thing, but it reacts like H2O, hydrogen is there, oxygen is there. When these two come in contact and mixes, becomes H2O, different thing, water. So the coronavirus, when it comes into contact with a living cell, then it, of course, replicates itself and does damage to our throat and lungs. That's what happens here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Vinodbhai, the next point is from Varshab and Gutka. Unfortunately, I can't get her on the mic, so I'm going to ask the question on her behalf. She made a point that there are so much charitable work abroad in India, and you talked about a lot of organizations doing that. And I think you also mentioned some charities here in the UK, but she also wanted to make the point that a lot of Jain organizations in the UK are also doing good charitable work. Maybe you could just respond to that.
Yeah, a lot of charity work being done by Jain organization. Oswald's got a Jivdaya Fund. Navnath has got Jivdaya Fund. Mahavir Foundation and other organizations have got Jivdaya Fund. And we regularly donate to various Panjra poles in India, educational institutes in India, and we donate money here in the UK in educational activities and heart charities, cancer charities, everything. These are all worthy causes, and it's our duty to donate as much as we can. Yeah.
Thank you. The next question is from Kajal Ben. Kajal Ben, if you could just unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hello, Kajal Ben.
Hello. Is pain always associated with violence? And if it is, then one sense beings don't really have a nervous system. So how would they be feeling pain?
Again, it's a difficult thing because the karma, sata vedaniya karma or asata vedaniya karma. That means pain and pleasure. Now the one sense living beings, of course, have only got a sense of touch and only few other pranas, which I had mentioned. I mean, let us see, and I'll show you that as well, if I can. Just bear with me for a second. Is it coming?
No, not yet.
Okay. Share screen. Right. This one sense being as mentioned, as a sense of touch. But it has got 6, 7, and 8 as well, all showing in red. So of course it can breathe. It has got a lifespan, and it has got certain physical energy. Very little. It might just flutter. It might just, something happens. Yeah, but that's all it is. So that is one sensed beings. And what exactly you want to know within that?
So I want to, Is violence associated always with pain? Because we're talking about non-violence and yeah, violence, and if we're killing any bacteria or if we're killing any one-sense beings, whether it's trees or do they feel the pain, like when you're harming them? Because they don't necessarily have a nervous system to feel the pain.
Even though you're right. I would like to said that one sense beings, they do not feel pain. But of course, we can have correction from our gurus, acharyas, and scriptures. But as far as what I have learned, because it has got no mind power, so wouldn't feel pain. But it's still violence.
I guess the violence is there because you're harming a living being.
Yeah, because you are taking away these vitalities.
Okay, so I guess when we talk about sort of violence, it doesn't, the being that is being, that you're being violent to doesn't necessarily need to show that they're in pain or doesn't necessarily need to feel the pain for it to be.
I understand, yeah. I would like to think that way, yes.
Thank you,
Kajal Ben. Next, we have Bharvi Ben. Bharvi Ben, please ask your question.
All of us here at the Goddess World team.
The question I had was, can we have an example of an act we can perform to remove fear from someone?
Remove fear?
Yes. So an act that I could perform to remove fear from someone.
Yeah. Because, as I mentioned, there are different types of fear. Fear of death, fear of disease, fear of something unknown coming to them. So if we can remove that, say a person is afraid of, and he thinks that he will die within 3 months, 6 months, because he has got some ailments, that can be removed. Say he's in need of a kidney or bone marrow or something. And if you find a donor, donate something, you will remove that fear and you will help us that way. So it's one kind of compassion. If the person thinks that he has got so much debt and the bank will take away his house or something, so you can do something, give shelter. This is the thing. It's a removal of fear.
Abhayya. Okay. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Bhavi Ben. Next, we have Hina Ben. Hina Ben, please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Jajinendra Vinodbhai.
Jajinendra.
How do you justify Supatradan? Like, for example, you see homeless people on the road and then you sort of think, okay, they're poor, and you sort of give them money. And this happens a lot in India, but then sometimes they are not really that poor. There is a business going on, like they collect the money and then they have their own business like that. So how do you justify that?
It's very difficult to determine that this person is a genuine beggar or not, or this organization will spend all your money in a proper way or not. Yes. It's difficult, I know. Because sometimes, say you write a check for £500 to one of the charities in India. Now you have to really trust them. You have to get some reports from other sources, but it's not an absolute guarantee. My outlook or my view is that it should not stop you from donating money. Because sometimes, I know the money is being wasted and it does not reach the right person, isn't it? Yeah, you donate some money to an organization. The organization says that we are helping poor people and we are feeding them. We are feeding, say, 1,000 people every day. Yeah. In reality, they might not be doing, they might be doing just the feeding 100 people instead of 1,000. So it is possible that you do a mistake, but you try and get reports, try and investigate a bit more, do other things, you know. But it's not an absolute thing. And as I said, it should not stop us from doing good work.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Vinodbhai, that is it in terms of questions. unmute everybody. And I'd like to have a big round of applause.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Before we finish with Pratna, just to let you know that next week we will be starting a new topic, and those details will be sent out in the normal ways via email and WhatsApp. We're going to be looking at a book by Acharya Sri Chandnaji on the book. Her book is Walk With Me, which is all about the story of Mahavir and his journey. That book will continue for several weeks in combination with a study of some of the main prayers within Jain Dharma. I will shortly ask Hinaben to finish with prayers. And after this, you will see a short survey on the screen, and then the meeting will finish. Please ensure you continue to be on mute. Hinaben?
So we are going to recite a very powerful mantra, Uvasakaram Stotra. I request you all to softly close your eyes, please. Uvasakaram Pasam Pasam Mandami Kamma Kadamukam Visara Visaninasam Mangal Kallani Avasam Visara Pulinga Mantam Kante Tarini Josayamano Tasakahero Kamari Dutra Chanti Usamam Chichauture Manto Tuche Panamo Vibau Falo Hoi नर प्रियेषु विजीवा पावन्ति न दुःख दोगच्छम् तुः सम्मते लब्धे चिन्तामणि कप्पाय वप्ये पावन्ति अविकेणम् जीवाय रामरन्थानम् ये संतो महायस Bhakti Varni Parena Hiyanam Tadeva Dicca Pohim Bhave Bhave Pasa Jina Chanda Bhave Bhave Pasa Jina Chanda. Now we recite Mangali. Chattari Mangalam Arhanta Mangalam Sita Mangalam Sahu Mangalam Kevali Panatotamo Mangalam Chattari Loguttama Arhanta Loguttama Sitta Loguttama Sahu Loguttama Kevali Pannatotamo Loguttamo Chattari Sharanam Pavachami Arhante Sharanam Pavachami Sitte Sharanam Pavachami Sahu Sharanam Pavachami Kevali Pannatotamo Sharanam Pavachami Char Sharana Char Mangal Charuttam Chekare Gavshakarmana Dubhute Sakal Karmano Aneyan Mukstana Sukhale Anand भाव तरीने जे गुण गाय जीव तरीने ते मोक्षे जाय संसार माही शरणाचार अवर शरण नहीं कोई जे नर नारी आदरे तेने अक्षय अविचर पद होई अंगूठे अमृत वसे लब्धि तणा भंडार श्री गुरु गौतम ने समरिये सदाय सदाय मन वांछित फरदातार भावे भावना भावे भावे दीचे दान भावे धर्म आदि भावे केवल ज्ञान प्रभु भावे केवल ज्ञान.